Good morning. Can you hear me? Good morning. Can you hear me?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Any questions before we start? Yeah. Okay, yesterday we talked about address space. And also introduce base and bound. Base and bound is a very simple technique, but it's effective, right? So generally speaking, given an address space of a process, then when we allocate physical space for this address space, then we set up the base and the bound. We find the physical space, then set up base and the bound, right? So generally speaking, that's the idea we discussed yesterday. So in terms of address space, you can think about that is a virtual address space. The advantage to provide a virtual address space is for programmer, we don't need to worry about where to put our program into the physical memory when we run this program. So we just compile based on this virtual address space. Then when we generate a process, we allocate the physical space, then set up base and bound. So we have a mapping between a virtual space to the physical space. Okay, that's the basic idea. Of course, base and bound, right? Base tell us where to put. Bound means provide isolation and protection. So a program cannot overbound. Okay, then we put the isolation, also protection, right? Okay, so I guess we can start now, formally start. Yeah, let me see. Okay, let me first open slides. Okay, today actually I'm at home. So my home network is not very stable. So sorry if we may have some issue, right? So don't worry. I mean, maybe you guys need to re-enter into the meeting. Okay, that's that happened for the online teaching, right? Yeah, usually I go to the office, but today somehow, yeah, I have to have some early meeting that it's lasted so long, so I could not reach to the office. Okay, so when we talk about base and bound yesterday, then we also introduce some overhead, right? So generally speaking, use base and bound for a virtual space, we have to map a physical space exactly same as the virtual space. So when I say the same as, I mean the size, right? So for example, if we have a virtual space, 16 kilobytes here, this virtual space. So when we try to run this, we have to find a physical space, 16 kilobytes. Although for some space, we never use it. We have to do allocation, right? So for a small virtual space, it's okay. However, our address space is huge right now. For example, for our IE32 architecture in Linux, the virtual address space for a process is 4 gigabytes. Okay, so it's impossible we map this virtual space with 4 giga physical space. Not only that, most cases we use very little portion. So it's unnecessary to allocate the whole space. So basically this is why people talk about segmentation, right? So the idea is very simple. So if the whole space is too large to map, how about we just map each component? So inside our address space, usually we have several parts, for example, program part, heap part, stack part. Then for each part, we do a base and bound. Then because we can control base and bound of each component, then compare the whole virtual space, now we can significantly reduce the size. For example, in this case, still is 16 kilobytes for our address space. However, we may only use 6 kilo to run this process. Okay, so that's general idea, okay? So generally speaking, now we have a code, heap, and stack. We have 3 segments. Then for each segment, we have a base, we have a bump, we call size here, okay? So we also talk about how to translate from the our virtual space, virtual address to the physical address, right? So we talked about last time, we talked about how to do it and so on. Then particularly given a address, virtual address, then we can allocate certain bits to represent segment, then other part as offset. Then based on this segmentation mapping table, then basically we can get physical memory address, okay? So we can either use a software approach to get this, or we can use hardware. Usually, if we use a segmentation, this part will be implemented by hardware. Okay, so for the stack, because the stack grow backwards, remember, stack is first in, last out, right? So somehow we have to set up this grow backward. So we have bottom. Bottom is our, usually when we have stack, we have bottom, right? Bottom usually is high address. Then we go up, then go to the lower address. This is our top of the stack, right? So generally speaking, if we look at the address, then stack will grow backwards. Okay. So for stack, we need actual hardware support, okay? So basically, then we have to add 1 bit for each, for our mapping table, for each segment, we have to add a direction. Okay, it's grow positive, which means from the low to high, the address, okay? Or is zero, okay? Stack is from high to low, something like that, okay? Basically, now we complete our segmented table, then use this mapping table, then we can, given a virtual address, now we can map to a physical address, okay? One good thing is we can use this method, we can share the code. For example, yesterday we discussed one example. We have two processes. They use the same code, right? P1 and P2, right? Remember that example? P1 and P2, then we put the P1 and P2 into different locations and do the scheduling. So if we, from different process, they use the same code. This is very possible, right? So I have one program, I run multiple times, right? Then they share the same code. So use the segment, okay? Basically, this is very easy, right? So we just say, okay, so we map this part, we just map our code into my physical, for example, this is our physical memory space, suppose, okay, from 32K to 34K. Okay, this is our code, right? Then for each process, we have mapping table, segment mapping table, right? Then basically for our code segment, we just map to here, then we can share the code. Okay, this is okay, right? In order to support this, then basically we also need to provide some bit to represent, okay, this segment is for what? For example, our protection can be, this is a read execution, this is a read write. For example, heap is a read write, stack is read write. Okay? The code is read and execution. You cannot write code. See, we don't allow you to change the code of a process online. That's very dangerous, right? So if we allow you to change, then we may have some trouble, right? Yeah, so usually we don't allow this to happen, okay? We don't allow this kind of a situation. So basically for the code segment, it can only read and do execution, right? So so you can see our segment table now need to put some bit. This also showed from yesterday's example, but we display the process image. Then you can see for each segment, we have some permission bit, read, write, execution, shared, or is private or shared, right, basically. Okay, so generally speaking, that's all for segmentation, okay. Certainly, we can have a coarse grain segment. For example, we only have a code segment, a heap segment, a stack segment. Okay. Or we can have a fine grain segment. Then we can even further reduce the granularity. Okay. Then certainly, if we do this, then we have to have a big table in our mapping table related to the segment, right? So this is a trade-off. Then basically, if we have fine-grained segment, then we may have big table, but because each segment can be, the size can be smaller, then maybe you can put into small physical space, then it allow more flexibility. However, generally speaking, segmentation is not a very good approach. Okay, so the reason is that you can think about this, okay? We have external fragmentation. Okay, so basically, what is the external fragmentation? So generally speaking, when we allocate our code segment, heap segment, stack segment, inside each segment, we can estimate the size of each segment, then inside each segment, we have better space utilization. So generally speaking, we see that we don't have internal fragmentation. Okay. However, after a while, you can see that our system may become like this. Okay, suppose this is a physical space. We have 16 kilobytes here, physical memory. Then our operating system is from 0 to 16 kilobytes. Okay. Then in the beginning, we may run some process. For example, here, we run one process, then another one, another one, another one, another one, another. Okay. Later, we just free, right? Free this part, free this part, free this part. You can see that we have a lot of small free space. They are not continuous address space. Basically, we separate. We have a lot of this small hole. The segmentation cause more fragmentation. Think about that. Now, for each process, we have three segments. We have to find the three place. Then after we release, it costs three empty slots, right? If these three empty slots are not adjacent to each other, then basically we have holes, right? Then if we have more and more holes, then now if I want to allocate space for a process. Overall, I may have a lot of space. For example, if I put, in this case, suppose I put all allocated process memory together. Okay, I move to here. I put those not used here. You can see we have a lot free space. However, those free space are scattered among this physical space. Then when we do allocation for a process, when we do allocation, although we have enough space, however, we may not satisfy the space requirement for a particular process, right? Think about that. So suppose my code segment, I need 32 kilobytes. Suppose, okay, then you see, you can see here, I do have 32. Do I have 32? Maybe my example is like, I want to have 20 or something, right? 20 kilobytes, right? So suppose I want to have a segment, the size is 20 kilobytes. So if we put them together, you can see our free space is over 20 kilobytes. However, if I go to each one, each hole here, each free space, I don't have enough space. Okay, so generally speaking, that's an issue, okay? So we call external fragmentation. So we have a lot of little hole of free space. Then it causes difficulty for us to find the big enough slot to do allocation, okay? So generally speaking, we may have X kilobytes free, but not in contiguous segment, okay? Then segment ask for X kilobytes, then we cannot satisfy. Okay. Then how to do it? How to solve this kind of issue? So this external fragmentation is not it's very common when we go to space management. So for the memory, we have this issue. For the storage, for example, our hard disk, we also have this issue, right? After we store a file, later we just delete this file. Delete this file means, okay, we release this space, this block, right? Then we may have this kind of block. So then this also is a fragmentation. They are not continuous. The address space is not continuous. So to solve this issue, one way is we can rearrange the existing segment in physical space. We call compaction. Basically, we can stop the running process, then we can move data to contiguous space area, then change the segment register value. Okay. Then think about that. This is very costly. When you do this kind of stuff. So suppose I run this process P1, P2, P3 right now. Then if we want to do the compaction, we have to stop everything. We have to stop running because we need to change base and bound. You cannot let the process to run at the same time you do the migration, right? So we have to stop, then change, then do the memory copy, then change the base and bound for each segment. Okay, then finally, you can finish this process. After that, then basically we have more contiguous physical space, then we can do better space allocation. Okay. So you can see, sooner or later, this become a headache, right? So if we use the segment-based approach, Intel provides this segmentation approach, then it's very difficult to handle. They call this global GDT, LDT, Global Descriptor Table, LDT. So they provide a set of this kind of descriptor for each segment. Okay. It's very hard to manage. Okay. So this is why people say, can we do better? Can we have some better approach? Okay. This is too complicated. Okay. And also, when we have those small holes, then we cannot fully utilize those small holes. Then we have to do the compaction. However, compaction is very costly. I have to hold the whole system. Then until I move the data code, then coalesce together, then finally change all registers and so on. So can we do better? Okay, so this is why people introduce another approach, a very simple, effective approach, which is commonly used, called paging. Before I go paging, let me answer some questions. Okay, so I noticed there are some questions here. Van Lan asks, but do we need to leave some space for the stack and heap to expand? Yeah, of course, right? So remember last time we show from our last time slides, you can see that we have a lot of space here. But in the beginning, actually, we will decide where is our bottom, where is our top for the stack. Also, heap is similar. Where is our starting heap? What is our current location of the heap? Then later, if we don't have enough space, we can extend a heap, and also we can change the stack also, yeah, the size. They are managed by a data structure called task, but basically it's a kind of we call process control block. You can think about that. Then inside we have a kind of a data structure called memory MM struct. So this one is used to manage our process image. Then inside we have stack, we have a heap, and so I think last time I showed this, right? If you guys, let me show you, that you know what I'm talking about. Somehow, yeah, what's going on here? Okay, discard. Yeah, I think last time, last slides. Yeah, this is a one common question student ask, okay, about the size and flip size and stack size, okay. So I think, I show you one slide here, right? So you can see here. So for this task struct, basically this is used to represent the process in Linux. Then we have mm struct. Then you can see we have stack here. Then we have heap here, start, and then we have text data BSS and so on. You can see correspondingly, you can see here we have a code, initialize the data, and initialize data. So this part basically is fixed. Okay, you don't need to change the size because in the beginning, the data, global data and so on have been defined. Okay, heap is malloc. So if you need some dynamic data, so you use malloc to allocate some memory space. The stack also, in the beginning we have stack and stack start, right? So if we don't have enough space, we can change this, okay? Similar to the our heap, right? But if they need to be extended to memory space, this don't worry about how we do this extension because if we use a segment based approach, it's very hard to do this kind of extension, right? You think about that. You already put some space, allocate some physical space for this particular segment, for example, heap segment. Now I want you to extend, change the size. It's very hard, right? You have to either find a new space or you need to find a continuous space, which is adjacent to your original physical space, then you can extend, right? So I think that's the issue. That's the issue. We want to solve the problem we want to solve, right? But that's a good point, okay? That's a good point. Very good question, yeah. So this is why actually we prefer to use paging. So this can be easily mapped and also easily do extension, okay? So the idea is very simple. Paging, the idea is very simple. You can see that in reality, okay? Usually simple stuff works, okay? Very simple idea. Basically, the idea is that so if a segment is very hard to manage, right, how about we use segment is very hard to manage, cause the external fragmentation. So then suppose we want to reduce this external fragmentation. One way is that we can divide our physical space into small pieces. Okay, paging, right? Split the address space into fixed size unit called page. Okay, so the idea is that now we will not cause any external fragmentation. Now, you think about that. The reason here is that because we allocate our physical space into small unit, so we have either this page is free or this page is allocated to a process, right? Think about that. Right. Then if this page is free, there's just no external fragmentation, right? Then we can allocate this page to any process. However, if this page has been allocated. Yeah, we agree. We do have internal fragmentation. So generally speaking, if I allocate this page to you, you may not use up this page. However, suppose this size, the size of this page is small. For example, a commonly used size is 4 kilobytes. Suppose each memory page is 4 kilobytes. At most, you will waste 4 kilobytes, right? Then it's okay. Yeah, I allocate this page to you, to a process. This process didn't use up this space, but they didn't waste a lot of space. It's only 4 kilobytes at most, right? So that's the idea. Then you can see after this idea, then everything becomes simple. Basically, physical space, physical memory is split into the fixed size unit page correspondingly called page frame. Then our logic space also is split up. Our address space, virtual address space, is split up into the page, okay? Then from the virtual address space to our physical memory, now we use a mapping table. We call page table. Okay, then use page table to do the mapping. So generally speaking, you can think about, okay, now we have an address space here, right? Think about that. Suppose this is our address space, AS. Okay, so we can divide this into logic space, a logic page. Page, right? We call page, okay? For example, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So each one is a fixed size, okay? Now, we can have a page table, page mapping table. Then for each page here in our virtual space, our address space. Now, we just say our page 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, okay. Where is map to? Suppose here we have physical memory here. Then we also divide into the same size, okay. Then we call it a page frame, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, for example. Then you just map, for example, this page map to 0, then I put 0 here, which means my logic page 0, is mapped to physical page frame 0 and so on, right? So then, as long as I satisfy this mapping table, we are okay, right? So page table per process is needed to translate the virtual address to physical address. So certainly page table now is more important because it defines our real address space, right? So our address space is a concept. You think about that. That's a concept. Now, to implement this, to map this address space into the physical space, we introduce a page table. Then through page table, then we can find the physical page frame. Then over there to find our physical memory correspondingly, right? Give you an example. Suppose this is our physical memory here. We have a physical memory here. Then we have three processes, P1, P2, P3. Each one has four pages in their address space. Okay, so correspondingly, we have a mapping table. You can see here, we have a mapping table to help us to map our virtual page to physical space, okay? Then basically, if you go to P1's virtual page 0, then we go to the physical memory 0, 1, 2, 3, right? Page 3 and so on, right? Kind of, right? So generally speaking, you can think about our page table, P1, right? So for this mapping table, we don't need to record the virtual page number, virtual address, virtual page number. We don't need to record this. This default, this, they are entry, right? Then we have array. Each mapping table is array. So basically for virtual page zero, our physical page is three, okay? Then virtual page one, our physical page is one. Virtual page two, our virtual page two, the physical page is seven. Our virtual page three here, the physical is 10, right? Correspondingly, you can build up P2. For example, P2, same, virtual page zero, physical page frame zero. Virtual page one, physical page frame four. Virtual page three, two, right? 0, 1, 2, 3, right? Three is a six, something like that. So can you guys help me to build up this table for P3? Okay, let me see. 8, 5, 9, 11. Yeah. One line, yeah, please write down. Yeah. 8. Finish. 5, 8, 5, 9, 11. Okay, great. Okay. Great. You get a lot of points now. Okay. In the final exam, I may put one question, right? So basically your paper-based assignment for, we will ask you to build up page table. Of course, it's not simple like this, right? We have to make it a little bit complicated, but generally speaking, this is what you need to do to build up the page table. Okay, so great. So I guess everyone know the basic concept now. Okay, so now let me continue. Yeah, somehow I could not continue. Okay, so why we want to use the paging? So first thing, it's more flexible. So now we don't need to worry about, for example, one student asks how to grow heap and stack, right? So originally, if we want to grow heap and stack, you think about that. This is very complicated because that's a segment, right? Then you have to find a bigger space. If this space is not adjacent to your current space, then you have to do some migration, compaction, and right, move your current heap and stack into that area, right? Something like that. So very, very difficult. And also we have external fragmentation, right? Then you manage those free space also is not easy. But right now, think about that, it's very simple now. We don't need to worry about the heap stack grow. Of course, we still need to worry if a user say, okay, I want to grow my heap. It's very easy, it's just find a mapping, right? You want to break, you want to extend your heap and just extend your virtual space, then create a mapping over there. That's it, okay, find a physical page frame, then put it into the mapping, finish, right? So stack also, if our stack is used up, we find, oh, this is, we don't have enough space for stack. So we want to grow stack, then we just go to our mapping table to extend that mapping, right? Find a physical frame, then put it into our page table, say, oh, this part of memory is valid right now, then map to this physical space. So it's okay. Yeah, so basically you can see it's more flexible. Also free space, can be easily managed. You think about that. Now, in principle, we only need to have a free page list. You think about that, right? So we have a free page list. So all those free page, you just put into a list. Okay, later, if you want to allocate a page frame, then you go to this free page list to pick up one. Suppose you want to see that I just always pick up the first from my list. Okay, it's okay. Then just pick up one. Then if you want to free some page, then you just put this into this list, right? You think about that. This is a very simple approach to manage free space. And do memory allocation also is very easy, okay? So this is why this has become a very, nowadays everyone, major processor, right? Of course, we have some embedded processor in which maybe we don't need a virtual space. We can directly use our physical space, write out some simple code, only one piece of code. Then in that case, we may not use this paging. Otherwise, if we want to utilize virtual space, then basically we use paging. Okay. As I mentioned, it's simple, right? Very easy free space management, right? The page in address space and the page frame are the same size, then we can use a free list to do it, right? Give you an example. Yeah, so let me check the time, okay? We only have 6 minutes now. Yeah, let me finish the example. So suppose we have 112 bytes physical memory, then our page frame size, our page size is 16 bytes. For example, this is our physical memory. You can see this is our physical memory, right? Then totally we have 128 bytes. Then each page is 16 bytes, right? You can see this is page frame zero, page frame one, right? Page frame one, page frame two, and so on, okay? So we have to divide our physical page and our virtual address space into the same size with the paging, right? So similarly, suppose our address space, our process address, virtual address space is 64 bytes. Okay, you can see 64. But here we also divide this into 16 bytes page. Okay, if you do this paging, then you have to have the same page size for your physical memory and your virtual address space. Okay, they must be the same size. Otherwise, we cannot do this, right? So then basically you can see that we have virtual page number, right? Page, virtual address space, page zero, page one, page two, page three, right? Correspondingly, page zero is used to represent the size from zero to 16, then 16 to 32 and so on, right? For page one and so on, right? So then our page mapping table, suppose this is our address space. Okay, now our page table, right? We have four entries, 0, 1, 2, 3, right? You can see that our first page, page zero, is mapped to here. Okay, so our page table here, three, right? Our page one of address space is mapped to seven, okay, seven. Our page two of address space is five, okay. Then our page three of address space mapped to page frame two, okay. Finish. That's page mapping table. Is that wonderful? Very easy, right? So
Yeah, so later you will realize it's after we have multiple level, then it become a little bit complicated. Yeah, but it's a good question. In practice and also in exam, this is a good question, right? So you only need to spend like 10 minutes, you can finish this question, right? It's not very difficult. Yeah, but it still needs some thinking. I'm not talking about this one. This is simple, I agree, okay? Don't worry, I will give you a very difficult question. Don't worry, okay? So you will get the difficult question, don't worry. Yeah. So let's look at a little bit of address translation, then I will stop, okay? Basically, in virtual address, we may have virtual page number plus offset, okay? Then for example, in this case, because our page, right? So think about our page size is 16 bytes, right? Think about that. Then, so 16 means we need 4 bits to represent, right? So our virtual address, you can see our address space is 64 bytes, right? So 64 is 2^6, right? 16 is 2^4. So you can see that our whole address space, our virtual address is, we only need 6 bits. Okay, then because our page size is 16 bytes, so we need 4 bits to represent the offset. Then 2 bits is used to represent our virtual page number. So we have 4 entries in our mapping table, right? So then use this mapping table, go through this mapping table, then we can map
page frame number.
What? Hello? Chunhong?
Oh, sorry.
Yeah. Any questions?
Yeah, I'm okay.
Okay. Yeah. So we have mapping table here, right? So basically we can map this through our mapping table, then we can get the physical address, right? Then put this offset together, then we get a physical address, then we can do memory access. Okay. So I want to stop here. So I think also the time is up. Okay, so this is all for today's lecture. Yeah, so I noticed we have some questions from the chat box. So I will go to the QA session. If you want to stay here, then yeah, you're welcome. Then, but that's all for today's lecture. Okay, if you want to leave, it's also okay. So it looks like we only have one question. So how many pages should be allocated to one process? So that's a very good question. Okay, so let me copy this question. So please continue to input your question. So how many pages should be allocated to one process? Okay, so to answer this question, we have several issues. The first one, page size, right? So we have to determine what is the page size. Usually OS will determine this, right? So based on the page size, then we can determine how many pages we need. Then, so how to determine how many pages we need for a process? Address space, think about that, right? Address space, right? So for example, in our previous example, we have 64 bytes address space, right? Then if our page size is, I don't know, how about we have 8 bytes, okay? Suppose, okay, each page is 8 bytes, then how many pages we need? right? We need 8 pages, right? Right, so it's, yeah, you can see this is how we determine how many pages we need, right? Did I answer your question? Okay, yeah, so it so basically this is not fixed. It depends on the page size. Then if page size is big, then maybe we have a smaller page table. We only have very few pages. But the trade-off is that we may have some waste inside of this page, right? Then on the other hand, if we have small page, then we may have a bigger page table. Right? We have more pages, right? Yeah, but this is a good question, right? We will talk about this page table size next time. Okay, let me go back to look at whether or not we have some new questions. Looks like we don't have any other questions. So remember we have a lab today. We have a tutorial today. So which is related to your bonus assignment 3, we call bonus assignment 3, but generally speaking is our first bonus assignment, which is a program related assignment. Yeah, and if you want to do that program assignment, yeah, please to attend the lab. If even you don't want to do it, then welcome to go to see real scheduler, how it works, okay? So I guess this is all for today's lecture, okay? See you next week. Stay safe and healthy. Bye-bye.